Party On. Here's a real quality one. Only two starts and give her a diamond. Party On. The party will go on right into the night.
Race number three on the program, the Sandy and Jan Yarnley two-year-old diamond, and the tentacles, if you like, run deep with Sandy and Jan Yarnley, of course, running Yarnley Farms, which is now where the Brecon Farm is. Not often we see this. A horse having just its second start turn up and reduce as much as it did in towards favouritism as well, Craig.
Absolutely, and the gates be quite amazing. Straight to the front within 200 metres. Big filly, fills a 61-inch hopple, so she covers the ground very quickly. At this point, she's in front. Delightful Memphis, I thought, went an absolute cracking race, could have did the most work in the running, set outside of the rest of the journey for Blair Orange and Mark Jones, an absolute super run. And of course, at this point, your favourite or second favourite in the Harness Jewels colours is a long way back Spanisher Mart.
Michael, I suppose the one thing that stands out about the start was Strawberry Strike didn't get off the gate and probably get to where most of us thought she would.
No, you're right, she didn't. Like a lot of these fillies, they've had a long season, and Spanish Amada's had a long season. She's been to war plenty of times. I think we're going to see this happen more in the duels. We're going to see horses who don't go to the sire's stakes or the early races emerge later, and I think that might be the plan with some of these bigger stables to maybe start their season later. Spanish Amada comes wiser in the yellow colours, but she's just not getting there quick enough. And we did say before the race, we thought three wide she may struggle, which is where horses tend to if they're not comfortable going a certain way. Comfortable Party On punters were feeling here, fellas. This was over an awfully long way from home. It's easy to say that, but it just was.
Yeah, well, it was the second pacing race of the day, and of course that crucial second quarter, almost running 31 seconds, Craig.
Yeah, absolutely. She got away with it, and she was always travelling so nicely. I thought there was two standouts on the day. This was one of them, but she just won with the ears pricked at the line. It was untouched. Quite great story. Mark Purden set this horse for this race 6 weeks ago as a maiden. Said to Ken Brecon, listen, I think we can win a race at Alexandra Park, get into the jewels, and I think she'll be competitive. That's the genius of the man.
6 weeks ago as an unqualified maiden.
Absolutely.
Which is even more remarkable. So look at this here, fellas. She smashes some pretty good horses, and she just has Oaks written all over her for next season. And before then, of course, she'll go to the Breeders' Crown. Again, coming up, maybe there's going to be a sort of a summer season and a winter season. Some horses will cross over, but a lot of the horses who we saw starring early in the year, fellas, are going to struggle to maintain that form as they grow and get stronger or weaker. So, as I said, if you're strong enough to have a big barn like they've got, you can see sort of thinking, okay, this might be my early horse, this might be my late season horse.
All right, of course, Ken Brecon's had great success as an individual owner, all the way back to Magiera, right through to I Can Do's It and the like. But an idea from David Sixton to put together some syndicates, get more people involved, has really sprung into fruition. And we hear from that man, Ken Brecon, now.
With what's unfolded not only here today, but in the last 24 hours, you might just party on.
Yes, that's right, Greg. We've had a wonderful 24 hours. We had Highgate win last night over an Aussie in Melbourne, the Victorian Oaks. And today, this just caps it off. Party On. What a great name. We'll be partying later on.
Listen, you've put together a number of these syndicates. You owned so many of the horses yourself. I Can Do's It springs to mind. And you've come up with a plan, you and Karen, to get a whole lot of people involved. So winning these races for, this one's the top 10, I think, syndicate, must be a great thrill.
Yeah, look, it is, Greg. And I'd like to thank on air David Sixton. He was instrumental in my wife and I getting involved in these syndicates. And we love bringing in new people to the races. My dear friends, Phil and Glenys Kennard, they've supported us from the start, from the first syndicate, and we've had a few of those. We've got new people coming in all the time. We've got Julie and Simon today, the first time they've been involved in racing. And that's what it's about, bringing new faces to the game.
What about this horse? She's come out of nowhere, Ken. Just her second start, she's now a Group 1 winner.
Yeah, look, she showed a lot of promise early on, but we had a few health issues. She actually fibrillated young, and she's a very, very big two-year-old filly. I think Mark said that she wears a 61-inch hopple. So, time's a great thing, and I think she's filled out now. She's an enormous Bettor's Delight, and I'd like to think now we'd look at the Breeders' Crown over an Aussie.
Ooh, you hate a trip away too, don't you?
I love a triple way, Greg. What are you talking about? I'm the first one to book.
Congratulations, mate. I know winning one here at Cambridge too, as you've done with I Can Do's It in the past, will be a big thrill, so well done.
Yeah, thank you. And I'd just like to thank the Cambridge Raceway. They've done a great job today. The weather's fantastic and a good crowd's turned out. And this Jules concept, there's nothing like it in Australasia. Fantastic.
Yeah, ears pricking as she went down to the line. She's got so much ability and untapped ability as well. Got to give some plaudits to both the runner-up and the third-place getter here. Spanish Armada had to come wide on the track. That was not easy for her. We know that. Delightful Memphis. She's had an unreal season when you consider, you know, who she's run up against and the races she's run. She was very brave.
Well, I think you've put the draws where Delightful Memphis drew four or Spanish Armada drew four, you probably might have got a different result. But that filly, I think time will be of a big benefit to her because she's so big. On Spanish Armada, I mean, 8 starts, 6 wins, 2 placings. She had a wonderful season. I mean, she didn't pace that well at Brown Cambridge, though. She hung very badly, especially out of the straight, and probably covered a little bit more ground than she probably wanted to and didn't steer that well. But I think she, no doubts, will get, obviously, 2 off filly of the year.
She should clearly get that and thoroughly deserve it.
Yeah, and she'll get a break too. Yep. She'll head to the paddock now. So they sat down Monday, Mark and Natalie, and worked out who goes where. Obviously this filly goes to the Breeders' Crown. She'll stay in New Zealand and contest the heat down south, potentially, or here in Auckland. Either way, then she'll head to the Breeders' Crown. Spanish Armada goes to the paddock. They could have pressed on with her, but she's got nothing left to prove, and she'll win 2-year-old filly of the year. Not sure. We said this about 6 weeks ago on the show, that this crop was that strong early on. There were 2 clear standouts, Spanish Armada and Delightful Memphis. We thought there was potential one would emerge next season. Didn't take that long.
No, didn't take it that long at all. So let's hear from the Beaten Brigade.
Blair, talk us through the run you got with this filly.
Yeah, look, Matt, we worked hard early to come forward and, you know, finally got the death sort of going to the straight the first time. And, you know, she relaxed pretty good outside party on and, you know, once again we've come up against one better again.
Does she strike you as a filly who may improve with a little bit more time?
Oh, for sure. You know, she hasn't gone a bad race this time in, and, you know, Jonesy's done a great job preparing her for every big assignment she's had, and, you know, I don't think she's run further back than third or fourth, so, you know, you can't comprehend what she's done, but she'll definitely come back a better filly next year.
To look at her physically, Natalie, what she's done as a 2-year-old is quite remarkable.
Oh, most definitely. She's not really your typical 2-year-old type. You know, she wears spreaders and everything. She's quite narrow and weak framed. So I think she'll just be a beautiful 3-year-old when she comes back.
How did she handle the track today?
Pretty good, really. Yeah, she had to do all the work out 3 wide. She never gave it away. I was just wrapped with her, really. Like, couldn't expect any more.
Where do we expect to see her again?
Oh, hopefully she'll go for a really good break now. Yeah, probably the other filly, maybe Breeders' Crown, but she'll probably go for a good break.
The other filly you speak of, Party On?
Yes, that's right.
What about Renska B? Is it a break horse as well?
Oh, most definitely, yeah. They've had a long season, them girls. She's been up every big race, so she's definitely ready for a break.
Nice cosy run and capitalised on it, David?
Yeah, no, she's not the worst filly, you know. There are a couple of class ones in there that beat her, but I was pretty happy with her run. She raced really well in the Sire Stakes one as well and produced another good run today.
Yep, great addition it was of the 2-year-old fillies event. Let's move on to the 4-year-old Ruby with Stallions Australasia.
Gentlemen, applaud a real champion. 7 Group 1s this year in Monbay. He'll get his second jewel as well. On another cold night
in December. What a season it has been for Monbay. Came from Barrier 8 to emulate what the likes of Changeover have been able to do at this very venue. And, well, he was simply magnificent. Gates about to roll here, Craig Thompson, and pretty much predictable. Sonny Ruby left it quickly.
Yeah, we thought what unfold happened early, probably what we didn't think would be how long it took Ricky May to get round. I think there was a little bit of a victim of circumstances with multiple gallops here at the start, but as we pick them up here at about the 1400, you'll see that Sonny Ruby's led. La Reverse dropped into trial. That's Princess McKendon galloping at that point. And you see your favourite 3 wide on the track here. Now, Ricky could have kept going, but he thought, no, there's a gap here. I'll pop back in and it'll settle 3 back on the outside on the back of Paramount Dream. Paramount Dream had a gallop at the 800 metre marker, Greg, and of course that's why Ricky didn't go a little bit earlier. But what it did do was set up a relatively slow middle stage, and Sonny Ruby had got away with it pretty clearly at this point, Michael, and to be fair, she probably underperformed.
Look, I think she did for sure, because being beaten by Mon Bay is no big sin. That's happened plenty of times before, as we see Paramount Dream gallop. So once again, Mon Bay, like Custodian, had to dodge some traffic, but she didn't beat horses who she would normally beat. Rain de Catan, for example, would normally have no chance of beating Sunny Ruby. She just had a bad day at the office. That's just life. On Mon Bay, you're expecting him to be parked, but as we saw throughout the day, getting to the park wasn't that easy when they go at this speed. Perfect drive by Ricky, because we want to see him go forward. We want to see him lead. You've taken the $1.30. You're all excited. You don't want bad luck. But Ricky just summed it up. Stayed out of the traffic early, and he was always going to win from here. Sunny Ruby underperforming aided some of the others, but a lot of horses here also underperformed. Five or six gallopers, not good enough for four-year-old trotters. Some of them have had a long season. Paul Nairn's horse La Revue is good. Ranga Katan. Well, there's, you know, the best performance of a career on the right day.
$20 a place running third, so it certainly helped the multiple investments. Royal Shine, who runs fourth, subsequently gets disqualified.
Actually, won a gallop. Huge race.
Actually, won a massive race to run fourth, but yeah, Mon Bay, he was just too good. And Greg, seventh Group One.
Yep, a great season, 13 from 15, a busy one. But, well, as we've seen there, the ability of the horse and of Greg and Nina to continue to get him to peak at the right time was certainly evident once again there. Let's hear from co-trainer Greg Hope.
He's simply been dominant today, Greg.
Oh, yeah, no, he went super. I mean, everything that could go wrong in the race did, really. Horse galloping in front of him around the first bend, they were galloping all inside him, so we're probably very lucky to have missed all that cartage.
Are you enjoying the ride? You've been in this industry for a long time, not necessarily at the Group 1 level, but are you becoming more comfortable in the environment?
Well, that's what your dream is, to have a horse as good as him, and we know they only come once in a lifetime. So, yeah, we are enjoying it.
Talk us through your emotions through the run. Do you get anxious, or is it so much confidence in RT May, because he delivers just about every time?
Oh, yeah, well, we leave it to Ricky. I mean, if Sully to give him instructions. We were a little bit concerned. He was talking about going out from the gate, and we felt that we could just work our way into it quietly, and lucky enough, Ricky decided to just ease out of the gate. So, yeah, no, he drives brilliantly, and who should we question him?
Seven Group 1s in a season. For some people, some great trainers, that's a lifetime's achievement. That's a remarkable season, isn't it?
Well, it just goes to show how good the horse is, really. Yeah, he's just a super horse. I mean, he's doing things that four-year-old trotters don't normally do, you know. So, yeah, if he comes back as good next year, he should be a force to be reckoned with, hopefully.
No reason to think that he won't. Congratulations to you, Nina, and young Ben, who has been doing a great job with the media when you've been absent, which is the odd time.
Yeah, no, that's great. Yep, no, really good. Thank you.
Emulating what Take a Moment and Stent have done in the last 15 years, and that is win seven Group 1s, but of course the only four-year-old who has achieved that. Nearly all unfolded for him though, as Greg alluded to there, right about this point, Michael.
Yeah, Paramount Dream's not as comfortable left-handed as right-handed, and she had a gallop. She wasn't the only sinner on the day, there were plenty of them. But Ricky's pretty calm, pretty relaxed, staying out of the early burn, proved out to be a masterstroke, and that's Ricky to a T, isn't it? We all know he's a wonderful horse, there's no surprises here. We've all seen the Group 1s. Next season, maybe it'll be stiffer. Speeding Spur, maybe he might come back at the back end, but Stent and Master Ladder should come back. I still think he's better than them. This is a very, very good horse. I said way back in December, I think he could potentially be the best trotter since Lowell Creek. I've seen nothing to deter me from that thought process. And being a love you, Craig, I would suggest he'll probably continue to get better. He's beaten all before him, and hopefully we'll see him for two or three more seasons.
I think we'll get at least three more seasons out of him. He's a four-year-old. What they've done with him is likely raced him, so he's raced sparingly, suggesting that he'll come back better at five. And they had a big call to make when they offered the big money for this horse. I mean, luckily enough, boys, he's won $250,000 in his last four starts, so the money has been a little bit irrelevant, and they've still got the horse to play with. And I suggest, like Michael does, that next season is a five-year-old, and that's where your trotters tend to be racing at their best at their five-year-old season.
And let's not forget, Sky Major's the only horse to have won three duels. This could have been him. Sunny Ruby beat him fair and square last year, but he probably wasn't at his peak then. He could have been the first trotter to win three duels. I reckon $1 million is on the agenda for him, possibly more. Next season stacks up beautifully for him. No speeding spur early doors. And if he goes to Australia for big races like the Great Southern Star, which is now one race instead of two, it might deter others from going. He might become a horse who changes the path of other horses.
All right, let's hear from the Beaten Brigade.
Bob, just talk us through the run that you got in Transit.
Great run, trailed Sunny Ruby the whole way, and horse went outstanding, just had a champion in there, too good for us.
Did he exceed your expectations today?
He's always been a nice horse, but like he was spot on the day, and you know, he went good, yeah.
It was a pretty nice effort, Andre.
Yeah, no, it was a good effort, you know. We were just going in there hoping for like the nice trip as you do in the trot fields, have a few gallop, and just got lucky enough to get the nice cosy run and found the line real good for a C1 horse.
Another creditable run from what is a wonderful mare and behind a very smart animal.
Yeah, a bit disappointing probably, Matt. Mombay, he was amazing. He never stopped working. He just, his class shone through, but she had everything go her way. We had a nice lead. She relaxed beautifully, like I expected around the bend when I clicked her up. She'd make him really work for it, but there was nothing there. She raced a bit flat, so I'm not really sure why. She seems bright now, so that's up to the trainer now. It'll be back to the drawing board and just see what shows up the next few days. But, yeah, a bit disappointed, but, hey, that's racing.
In a reflection of the season overall, though, you must be pleased as to what she's achieved.
Oh, absolutely. And more so, like, her racing manners. Like, to be able to come off the gate and then relax like that just shows how far she's come. And again, and behind, when she relaxes, she's showing what she's capable of. So a season of this sort of racing under her belt, then we're pretty excited about next season and what it'll bring.
He's come a long way in a short time, this horse, Dexter.
Yeah, no, Sam's done a great job with him. He's raced really consistent all season, Matt. It's a shame we got disqualified. But he did run a great race, and he should keep doing a good job too.
All right, just talk us through what went on in the room.
Yeah, it was pretty much just a formality, signing a piece of paper, really. Rules states you can't get up for more than 150 metres of the race. So I think we were about 230 metres, so, it was pretty clear cut.
So a muscle mass quinella in the two-year-old trot and a love you trifecta in the three-year-old. It's a great day for a couple of those stallions. But let's move on to the Dunstan feed, three-year-old dime.
His cold shot, Christian Cullen passing lane, bang, the Jewel Oaks winner. It's a Jewels winner. Piccadilly Princess, Golden Goddess, and Dream About Me.
Passing lane win for her, third win in the harness, Jewels for Tim Williams, at just his second appearance, if you like, for that stable. An amazing season it's been. A horse that only qualified at the start of it, started her racing career, has done it all on one preparation, the filly by Bidder's Delight. Raced by the Patterson brothers, who run the Commodore Hotel, where so many harness racing people, including the conference people, each and every year stay. Out of Hyde Park Royal, Jack Smolensky's breed, yep. Another string to the story, if you like, and Mike Ward, who's also been a big part of the Commodore. So a really nice story around this horse, and she was in the right place at the right time, Craig, and she's won now 9 from 17.
Yeah, on a limited preparation, first raced in September and still going in the middle of June. She got across Killer Queen like we thought at the start, and then she handed obviously Golden Goddess. What's unfolding for Dream About Me is the gaps never appeared for Mark to get her off the fence. She tried to get off a couple of occasions, but Appassionato had kicked up there, and that's your favourite back third to last on the fence, and was in all sorts of trouble at that point, Michael Guerin.
Sure was. One of those strange races, fellas, where you were watching the start, but you were also watching what was going on back in the field. And look, Mark had no chance to go up there. It just never worked for him. And you knew here you were absolutely stuffed. No chance you could win, regardless of what happened next.
As much as where she was positioned, but those that were in front of her were going to be at least to her equal.
Because it was a very strong field, Greg, and because the second favourite was in front, they weren't going very fast. So the horses around her weren't going to stop. She'll get out later, we'll see that. Piccadilly Princess, remarkable story, actually started her racing career on September 27th at Motocarrara in that rain-soaked meeting where they came home in 68 seconds in the Banks Peninsula Trotting Cup. Then raced the boys, Motu Premier, over the Cup Carnival. So she's had a vastly different racing season, and of course she's been to Victoria. Here, Golden Goddess simply should have won. She should have been good enough to win. the best golden goddess, Piccadilly Princess, was simply too good for him.
Jewel Oaks winner is a Jewels winner. Piccadilly Princess, Golden Goddess, and Dream About Me. Rocker Razor might just get fourth.
So up the passing lane she came. So let's hear from Tim Williams about how that unfolded.
Congratulations to you, Tim. She got the draw to operate from today, and effectively that was the winning of the race.
You know, it's dead right. She's had some tricky marbles throughout the season, and you know, it was a fitting way to end the season, be able to come up with a good draw and get the good run. And you know, full credit to the horse, she was good enough to capitalise.
Right, sitting in the trail behind Golden Goddess, following the right horse, and obviously the other horse to beat was further back on the inside. Were you well aware of that during the run?
Yes and no. I knew he was behind me. I couldn't see him getting out sort of too much early, but you know, I was conscious of the one I was following too in front. Obviously. Yeah, Natalie's filly's a very good filly in her own right, and you know, it took me a wee way to get past it.
Your third Harness Jewels, all in the space of a year. You're living the dream at the moment, aren't you?
Yeah, very much so. Look, I'm just lucky to be able to work where I do and the people I work with. And you know, it's a credit to Mark and Natalie, this horse, you know, to qualify at the start of the season and to win three Group 1s, you know, it's a real credit to them.
You're sitting in the bike. There's a few sitting at home watching this, and many of them up here with the big 16-horse team you've got. A bit of credit to some of the staff at home as well.
Oh, very much so. You know, it's a team effort. Obviously, headed up by Dwayne. You know, he's the ringleader at home, and, you know, credit to him the way he directs us around the barn and what we do and whatnot. And you're very lucky to work underneath him.
Congratulations, mate. Well done.
Thanks very much.
Yeah, pretty good time overall in the end. They just kept running even quarters. That made it impossible for Dream About Me to get out. So let's have a look at her at the start. I had a theory, Michael. It was probably, I was wanting rather than in reality. It was,
you're just punishing punters today, well, making them watch this again.
I remember you asking me pre-race, what do you think will happen? And I was wanting her to get out as opposed to...
The heart versus the head?
Yeah, I think so.
You know, the difference was here, because the field was so strong and these are well-raced, experienced fillies, there's just no gaps. There just wasn't the move there, any chance at all. And look, Mark knew, knows here he's stuffed. What can you do? If he pulls back to last, you gut her, and she still can't win. Mm. So she flies home. I've got no doubt she's the best of the crop. Here she gets off eventually. Mark squeezes out, but it's way, way too late. Look, I'm willing to give him a lead pass on that. There's no harm, no foul there. Sometimes you can't win. I'm surprised Golden Goddess got run down. Maybe Piccadilly Princess is a better horse than we think. Only go back 3 or 4 months. She beat Golden Goddess at Methven. Craig and paid $19. You'd love a punt on that again.
Yeah, and she beat her in the Oaks fairly and squarely as well. So she's had a stellar season. Three Group 1s. I think what really aided her chances, boys, was they put the half blinds on her to sharpen her up. It got her off the gate, got past Killer Queen and into the right spot, and that won a race. I thought just a little bit of praise too for Raka Razor and Clark Barron. I mean, he made the big trip up with this filly. I mean, he's got fourth money. He's got certainly well and truly paid her way.
Yep, she certainly did. So let's hear of those beaten brigade.
Natalie, in terms of the race, were you pleased?
Oh, I was pleased. I think just, you know, beaten by a bit of filly on the day. You know, the other filly had the good set on me, top of the lane. I sort of knew I was in a bit of trouble. You know, Picker was pushing my helmet. And my filly went good, but the other girl just went better.
Right. Where do we see her going next?
Not too sure. We'll just probably assess it all now, whether we go for a break or go Breeders' Crown.
I suppose there's not much more that we can say, barring being unlucky.
Yeah, that's right, mate. It was one of them races from the draw that, you know, you had to accept that might happen. And yeah, we just need a Killer Queen to get off that gate a bit quicker. But, you know, the class comes to the top, and the other two are class fillies too.
Do you have any immediate plans for her?
She'll probably go to the Spelling Paddock now, and she'll be looking at the bigger mares races sort of around Christmas time.
James Raka Razor, just talk us through the run that you got.
Yeah, well, we went out there, we didn't think we had a chance of winning, so we decided to take all the shortcuts and had a chance to get onto Mark's back, so we sat there, and when he came out around the last bend, I just went the fence the whole way, and she found the line really good. We're never going to win it, but, you know, she ran a credible fourth.
All right, so there's a wrap on the diamond. Michael, just one question. It seems logic, Dream About Me will get three-year-old filly of the year, but almost pretty much parallel these two horses. Yeah. One's won 9, Piccadilly Princess, Dream About Me 8, and one of those, of course, the Breeders' Crown Final in August.
Probably more so the fact that Piccadilly Princess has been beaten more, so you sort of lose a bit of lustre, but three Group 1s for each of them. So biggest surprise out of this, all three go to the paddock. I was sure they would send one to the Breeders' Crown. They're not going to. Now, My Mackenzie is in Sydney, racing in the Breeders' Challenge, June 26th, the final there. She'll go to the Breeders' Crown, but I thought one of these would keep going. They're all coming back. That gives them an incredibly powerful team for the mayor's races the next couple of years.
All right, good information there. Of course, leading in to the Harness Jewels, you've had some wonderful information via Marianne Twentyman putting together a whole lot of driver historics, etc. As part of that, we found out there were some bloopers involved, so here's another look at that.
Harness Jewels. Stop laughing.
Cuts long?
No, not yet.
Really?
Now I know.
How are we going to do this?
So... that was quite hard.
Sorry, a little bit of booger come out.
What was it? Diamonds, emeralds.
Is it emeralds?
Emeralds.
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 Say it again.
Don't beep and miss it.
Can make up in my eyes now.
Say it again.
Recording now. Yep. How serious do you want me to look?
Well, thanks, Brody.
Diamonds, emeralds. Why don't you get a better name, like gold or something? Yes.
Doing the McGarren Pout. I get more excited when you say it before me, like you're excited. Gets me excited.
Diamonds. What is it?
Diamonds. Three!
I know, it's one, yeah.
One of those. That is rough.
Boom.
Diamonds, emeralds.
I'm trying to do it like you.
This is right up there with the weirdest shit I've
ever done. I know it is, but you love it.
Girls say I have a cute smile on you.
Jeez, that was a good shot too.
Lucky I remembered it.
I'm sorry, sorry.
Rolls.
Rolls.
Yep.
How am I standing that? Marianne Twentyman at trackside.co.nz if you want to send her a bad email.